Tim Lee. There's the CEO himself. Oh, yeah. Is my battery low? It says one bar, but it's slightly low.
Oh.
Oh, yeah, we can share. Right.
Oh, you got it. I'll just park it towards you.
Yeah, sure. You got the thing on? Yeah. Just
letting
you know, I
want to
be that guy. Have a little stereo mic action. You're going to have five active mics?
Two, three are mine and two are business.
Two people think they have a mic.
Yeah. These are.
They'll just dub it in later.
Home props.
Yeah, send it to
Taiwan.
Hilarious. Send it
to a little movie.
Hmm.
My name's Rick. I'm an alcoholic. Anybody hadn't been to an AA meeting, that's kind of what it looks like right now.
So, we doing intros or we don't?
What's funny is that's real, but yeah. 27 years sober. I'll be 28 on March 17th.
Congrats.
Yeah, almost 30 years from crack.
Congrats, you made it.
Yeah, I'm a statistic. On the good side, on the plus side.
Yes, true. Okay. Bounce out the equation. Right, who's kicking this segment off?
I guess I'll do a quick intro. So, as you know, this came in, we kind of wanted to take ourselves out of it because I'm sure we're getting sick of our ugly mugs. So instead, we got these beautiful people up on the panel. Give them a round of applause. Grind is going to be leading the session and then talking through the panel. It's going to be about marketing strategies. Hopefully you guys can kind of partner with everyone else. A few things that have been working for you, maybe some nuggets from like social media, so even like email open rates, stuff that worked for you, anything at all. And you guys feel free to ask questions. We'll make it kind of like an interactive session. And then we got Billy from Big Shot Beats. You guys know him. He's one of our coaches and MIDI money. We got Wishmaster Beats, super successful producer who did I'm on a boat, Lonely Islands. He worked with Melly, lots of cool people, so I'm sure he has an interesting story to share with you guys. We got, of course, the man himself, Busy Works Beats. I'm sure many of you guys have watched his tutorials, his YouTube channel, all that good stuff. And then, of course, Gabe already introduced Mr. Rick.
Not as talented as these guys. Yeah.
So, yeah, you guys are in great hands, so I'm going to pass you off to Dylan.
Cool.
Here we got Dylan.
Yeah. Okay. I get two rounds of applause. How come they didn't get no round of applause this time?
Dylan, you're the all-star.
Oh, hell no. I'm going to try not to kick my coffee, man. But cool, man. I've never done a panel before, but this will be dope, man. We got four of us up here, four OGs in the game, man. We got Billy from Big Shot Beats and Wishmaster. You guys are kind of well-established and selling beats online, gone through several different waves and market changes and stuff like that. We got Busy Works. I know you kill the marketing as far as like marketing to producers. Have you ever like sold beats and stuff like that? Or?
In a sneaky way.
In a sneaky way? Yeah. Is that how it started or?
It started with YouTube.
Being doing tutorials and stuff.
Yeah, and then the ad realizes monetization, and then you realize how to build products.
Okay, cool, yeah.
I can tell my journey, but I don't want to dig too deep.
No. You guys interested in hearing this journey? I am.
So, in a nutshell, YouTube, you get monetized. I was helping out friends in a Facebook group. Everything Gabe and Anno basically said, AD basically said. Anyway, long story short, YouTube monetization, that I was making $500 a month. I was like, wow, I thought that was a lot of money. But it was sustaining me while I was living in my mom's extra bedroom. And all I had was a laptop that was hot on my lap and a dream. So I took out a piece of white paper, wrote out exactly what I wanted to do. In the next 48 hours, I translated that thought into my first website. And I learned from Jeff Walker that you brought up, learned from my mentor, Frank Kern, how to build info products. And I went from making $500 a month to $4,000, $6,000 a month. It kept going up and up and up. And I was like, this is a real thing. And I got addicted to the ups. Like, it just kept going up and up and up and up and up.
How long did it take you from start to actually making any kind of money?
That's a good question. Probably like that's a good question. I don't know how long I was monetized on YouTube, but it got me through college. I didn't have the meal plans. Who has a meal plan in college? Anybody? Nobody? What? Like a couple years I had the meal plan, but for the junior year and senior year, I couldn't make the meal plan. So I had to figure out a way to like survive.
Yeah.
So what was your question again? I'm sorry, I don't know.
Trauma.
From A to
money. Yeah, and not so much YouTube monetization, really selling products and selling services and selling information and stuff. Like when you, from like idea, I'm launching this website to like, okay, I'm actually making some money.
Good question. I would say I realized after 6 months, but immediately when I did it, it was instant. It was like a huge jump. So it's just about taking action.
How did you bounce back when your laptop crashed and everything just got to be?
Hey, this is my family. I'm just messing with you.
He's like, welcome to producer mom. Yeah,
in a few years, my seat will be right there.
That's right.
Let's go, let's go.
You wished it, you visioned it. We'll see.
Well, you're sitting kind of close, right? Yeah. But your question was, how did I go? Just store stuff on the cloud, you won't have like panic attacks.
And Rick, I want to get to you in a second, especially I definitely want to know how you go from being an industry guy manager to like all of a sudden ClickFunnels guys, but I want to ask Big Shot and Wishmaster, because I know what were you doing before making beats, and how did you start selling beats? How did that even come about?
Like the original way, or when I came back?
Oh, you took a break.
Well, I was working in the industry.
Oh, okay.
Selling beats online.
Gotcha.
How I first started was, I was working as a security guard. I liked making beats. I was a DJ in Chicago.
Okay.
And then I loved Timberland, same people, Dr. Dre, Neptunes, and I started making beats like them. And I just started putting them online on mp3.com, and they used to pay us for streams back then. So I basically sat in my parents' basement just clicking on my own shit. Yeah. You know, because I'm
trying to run it up.
Not knowing there's an IP address. So, yeah, you know, I spent like hours just to get one click. But I was getting paid for like $50 checks here and there, and I was like, this is cool. You know, I haven't made any money for music. And then they stopped paying us. So I was like, well, what am I going to do with these beats now? I'm like, all right. So I went through my emails, and I saw these emails like, oh, how much do you want for this beat? And I sold my first one for like $50 because that was my phone bill. And then and just grew from there. And then I started selling exclusives only. And then people couldn't afford to buy those anymore. So I came up with, there's a couple of us came up with the idea of releasing beats, and which is, you guys all know what it is now. It's just cheaper price to sell your beats. And then not anybody owns them except for you.
So yeah.
That's how I got into it. And then I got in the industry from that. People found me from doing beats online. So.
Fire. And then I got to ask you this, because AD and Gabe talk a lot about when something works, go all in on it, double down, triple down.
Yep.
What has been the main factor in your mind that have you've been able to like, okay, mp3.com is done, SoundClick, run it up, it's done, BeatStars, whatever, run it up, and now, you know, onto the ClickFunnels and stuff like that. What's been, like, what would you tell everyone here, like, is something that they can develop to make sure they're on it?
You need to stick with it, first of all. I see a lot of people getting discouraged and they're like, oh, I just, you know, it's not working for me. Well, how long have you been doing it? 3 weeks. I'm like, yeah, you have to go a little longer. You have to test things. You can't test things for a day and then change them. I notice a lot of people change their funnels, like I said, every like couple days, and that's not going to work for you. Research yourself. I think they said best. As soon as I learned from them, I did the one-time offers right away. I did the, deadline funnel? That's probably my biggest moneymaker right there. Just as soon as he mentioned it, he said, don't anybody do this, I did it. I funnel hacked Anno, and I got his order bump. I did exactly like that. And I think when I started researching and learning from them, I just kept with it, and it just kept growing from there. But my biggest thing is I talk to every customer. I don't care if they spend $1 with me, if they spend $1,000 with me, I answer every email right away. I go on there, even if they piss me off and they say, I didn't get the free beat, and I don't say, hey, asshole, it's right there on the first page, you know? But I just say, hey, it's down below, enjoy. You know, it's in the email that you just responded to. I always take the higher ground. If someone gets angry with me, I say, well, is there anything I can do to help you? Sometimes I get an upsell just by doing that. All right. Customer service definitely is number one. I'm still with BeatStars. My BeatStars sales have gone up since I've been doing this.
I remember you saying that when we did the funnel critique.
Yeah, because I made 12K last month just off of funnels and BeatStars.
Fine.
And it's because I did. Thanks.
Yeah, clap that up.
Well, I also want to say I'm not doing this before. I made $22,000 last month from making beats, because that's all I did. I made beats in my parents' basement, and now I get royalty checks. I just got 7 placements with Strange Music because they saw me hustle online. Pretty much when I'm a teacher, I'm an instructor, I started my own school here in Nashville. But when I got into doing that, a lot of people in the industry kind of gave up on me and said, oh, he's teaching now, he gave up. And then when I came back to selling beats online, I hustled so hard that they're all hitting me up. Like Travis from Strange Music's like, dude, like I see you every day, I see your fucking ads, like what are you doing? Like you guys are beat. He's like, man, send me some stuff, I got all these new artists and stuff. And Stevie Stone, same thing. He's signed a Strange. He hit me up. He's like, dude, I see you're working, man. Like, send me some tracks. And it's all because of me hustling online. And like, I tell you, you could chase that stuff, but it will come to you when people see you working. You think Cash Money was running ads? No, he's on everybody's price now because he was just releasing beats on YouTube, giving away for free, and people found him.
One thing I'll add to that too is when you do hustle online, especially like if you guys are working jobs right now and stuff like that. Putting your all into I want to be a producer, I want to get places, I want to be working with these artists, but I need some income first, you know what I mean? I need a base, I need to be able to not have to sell my time, you know what I mean, for $10 an hour, $15, $20 an hour, you know, to work a job. So I know that obviously most of our first goal is to like escape working and be able to be an entrepreneur full time, right? And that's, I think, why everyone's here. But that's huge, man, because like a lot of you guys know me from the podcast, but the only reason I was able to start the podcast and build that brand is because I went all in on selling digital products first and was able to sustain and pay my rent and move to Atlanta to where I could be able to move around. I know this is not about me, but I just want to, you know, throw that in there. Big shot, man. So you started End of SoundClick days, early BeatStars days. What were you doing before?
So just to take everybody back, like everybody else, I went to school and I went to college for computer science, and then I went to university for software engineer.
Mm-hmm.
And then after, like within the first year, after my first intern, I realized that I didn't want to do that for the next 30 years of my life. So I quit school, my mom wasn't too happy about that. And then, you know, I started a little record label with some of my childhood friends.
Dollar and a Dream type shit, no?
Yeah, so we kind of just went in, kind of build our name in the local community and stuff like that. And we even got to make an album with one of my friends that was actually the actual rapper. I was like the in-house producer. And then, you know, we even went on tour with a little mixtape that we kind of put together and stuff like that. You know, majors started to have eyes on us and stuff like that, but it never amounted to anything. Like, it didn't work out. And then, you know how sometimes, you know, when friends do business together, it doesn't always work out.
Right, right.
So we kind of split ways, and then this is actually the moment where I decided to move out of Montreal because we were in the French hip-hop market. So I said, okay, let me try to, you know, do my own thing in Toronto, which is closer to the English market kind of thing. And then so I moved out there, and then I was still chasing, like, you know, the major artists, the major record label, but none of that was working for me. Like, I never really had any success with that. And then one day I was like, how about I, you know, find out how to make, you know, money online but selling beats.
Mm-hmm.
So I went in and then I started learning, and then I came across the one dude we were talking about that earlier, you know, shout out Postman, by the way. And he shared the principal basic concept of, you know, having a funnel and using email marketing to promote your business and to get it going. So right away, it really stumbled upon me to understand the concept of building a list, you know, having your own website, basically ownership, right? Instead of relying on something, you know, you build your own website, you build your own email list. And then I started doing that stuff, but it wasn't working. Like it still felt like something was missing, right? I would start getting sales here and there, started helping artists with my stuff and everything. And then I started doing paying on, like, using advertising for my business, and that didn't work out as well. Like, I was learning the concept, implementing everything, and I actually went broke spending money on paid advertising at one point. So I had to get back and, you know, get a job and stuff like that and kind of build myself up. And then at that moment, I also went and did affiliate marketing. So I kind of put my music business to the side because I was like, yo, I need to take a break. Maybe, I don't know. I need to figure my stuff out. But then I started doing affiliate marketing. And like within a month or two, I quit the job that I was doing. I actually went on and, you know, washed some cars for a little while. And then that, because I said that at one point in my journey, I'm going to buy a car washer. I need to figure out a little bit of what's going on with that stuff so that I can come back and actually get one or whatever. But anyways, I did that for a little while. But within like 3 months, when I got into affiliate marketing, because I invested in myself and I got myself a mentor, I figured how to market, like really dived into marketing. And then because I did that, you know, within a week, I generated $1,000, and then, you know, I had a $3,000 day within the second week. So I was like, whoa, okay, this is a major change.
What kind of affiliate products, real quick?
So affiliate marketing that I used to do is high ticket offers. So, you know, $1,000 product that you're affiliate with. So basically you get one sale, you get $1,000. Okay, so okay. If you know how to communicate right, you get the sale and stuff like that. So I started doing that and I got myself up to making like $6,000 in one day. But I still felt like something was missing, and it was hurting inside that I wasn't doing that with music. So at one point I said, okay, hold on, let me take a step back and really realign myself with my true passion, which is music. And I really became passionate about the marketing of things. So I started applying what I learned with affiliate marketing, all of that stuff, with the music. So I kind of rebuilt my brand and rebuilt everything that I was doing. I was already doing funnels before I met everybody and the community and everything like that. But
I've been doing this shit.
Yeah, it's like, yeah. And I, you know, I've been doing funnels, but it still wasn't working. I was getting minimal results and stuff like that. Nothing to be proud of, right? And then I still invested in myself, and I put myself into, you know, Music Entrepreneur Club and a few other.
Shout out to Payne One.
Shout out Payne One. You know what I mean? And one day, he brought Gabe on, and he's like, he made $1 million off of selling beats online using funnels. So I was like, are you kidding me? Like, I was asking myself if that was even possible. You bring him on and he just started talking and talking about all this stuff that I like. I was like, this is God sent, because I was trying to figure out a way. Like, I was asking myself, like, is it even possible, like, to even generate that kind of income selling beats online? But I kind of wanted to do it for the community so that I can come back and share my knowledge of how I did it. So that was my goal, right? Like, I wanted to learn this, make it work, get the two come up club kind of thing, and then come back and like learn everything. And then Payne One bring him on the call. He's like, two come up club winner, you know, you made $1 million selling beats online. So I was like, okay, this is the spark right there.
Yeah.
There's hope. And it's really what, you know, got me going. And then right away, you know, I hopped into whatever he had going on back then. The webinar happened, and then even before the webinar was done, I was already invested in this kind of thing. And then I took action, and then before all of that, I didn't understand the concept of offer, because I was already, you know, following Russell Brunson's stuff, and then you know, the funnels and all this stuff. And when I really put an offer together following his and Anno Domini's step, that was the missing link right there. And then everything kind of, you know, evolved from there. And then that was the major breakthrough from my journey of up and downs and everything that's been happening. So this is kind of the story there.
Fire. You know? Hell yeah. Real funnel come up story.
Oh yeah.
So Rick, man, got a couple questions, man. First, we definitely got to find out a little bit about your background, you know, managing Taylor Swift. And I want to know, you know, how you got into all that, and then why the switch from, you know, focus heavily on the industry to now focus on, you were just at Funnel Hacking Live.
I was.
And you're, you know, kind of all in on this online marketing stuff. Yeah. You were there too. Yeah, well, dope.
So for me, I'm a product of divorced parents. My mom's been married 5 times, dad's been married 5 times, went to 3 different high schools, grew up in Muscle Shoals, Alabama. Some would still question whether I've grown up at all, but the Christians and the jocks took me in, so I went to church and I played soccer. That was my passion. And then I ended up going to live with my dad in California my senior year, and the stoners took me in. And I started doing drugs when I was 18 years old. And got hooked, and I'm 53 years old, so I grew up, I would have graduated around 1985, for those doing the math, but instead I ended up hitting the streets. Someone turned me on to crack cocaine. I took it, and I chased that high for like 4 years, so I lived on the streets. I was always an entrepreneur. I worked as a DJ in a strip club and sold drugs from the strip club. So in the 80s, I was in right down there in Hollywood, so it was like, you know, all the hair bands would come into my club, and I realized they like drugs and women, so I started supplying them at all the parties and things like that. I saw an opportunity, and I took it. Then I had a guy come up to me and approach me, and there's two gangs in Los Angeles, the Bloods and the Crips. And one of these guys, he was with the Bloods, he said, listen, he says, I'll give you all the free drugs you want, but for 3 hours from this time of night, would you stand on the corner, because most of our clients are white, and if we have a white guy selling drugs, we might be able to make more money. So I'm like, free drugs? Absolutely. You know, I've spent a lot of money on drugs, you know, so this was like a great opportunity, and then almost got killed in that situation. It's like, it's when you're making money, it's cool until the person that was making the money doesn't think it's cool anymore, and some realistic things happen. But on wrap that part up, but on April 4th 1989, I was smoking about 7 grams a day and weighed about 111 pounds, had long hair, and for the first time I saw myself in a mirror, and I didn't like what I saw, and I got on my knees and I asked God to let me die, and I went to sleep and I woke up, and haven't had a craving for cocaine since that day. But what I realized was that drugs was just kind of like a symptom. Now, the reason that I tell my story of drugs and jail and things like that is because a lot of times, whatever room I'm in, inside somebody's going through something, and I just want to tell you that your past does not define your future if you don't want it to. And I say, how did I go from strung out on crack to launching the biggest star in the world? Because there's that middle part of the story that everybody thinks is just, I want to be there. Without this, which is what you guys are writing about and producing about, there is no there. So I kind of share that story because everyone thinks you need to go to music school and you need that. No, all you need to do is solve people's problems, period. So what I always wanted to do is I wanted to be in radio. That was my dream. I never had the talent or the discipline to learn an instrument. I'm no rocket scientist, and, you know, shit. But I just not that way. It's like, boom, boom. It's like, no, I would find the talented people and promote them. And radio is what I always wanted to do. So I heard him talk about an internship. I went and got an internship. Ended up at Kiss FM in Los Angeles as a producer. And then I got my first job to go on radio in Santa Barbara. Went to Santa Barbara, did that. And we had a really cool music scene going on in Santa Barbara for a while. At one time, we had like 9 bands signed. It was Toad the Wet Sprocket, Dishwalla, Ugly Kid Joe. During that whole MTV days, those bands were getting signed out of there. And I produced my first 2 records. I was the executive producer, which just means I had the radio that could promote the record. So they gave me a cool title called executive producer. But I just love promoting bands. I've always loved promoting bands. Hip hop has always been one of my favorite genres of music. I just, you know, I'll Sugar Hill Gang with anybody. I just have always loved music. And when I got a chance to build a country radio station right after 9/11, the world was in a different place, and I figured they asked me to build it. I was hip hop, alternative rock station. We had this thing, I don't know if anybody's old enough to remember pirate radio, where you could go from Motley Crue to LL Cool J on a radio station. It was like the ultimate playlist before there was even playlists, and they just played whatever. And they asked me to build a country radio station. I'm like, you know what, I grew up in Alabama and I knew who Johnny Cash was, so I figured I was as qualified as anybody else. And I got what's called reporting status at a radio station. So I was the program director. So now the record companies would start calling, trying to, you know, grease the wheel to get you to play their music. By the way, the music you hear on the radio isn't necessarily always the best. It was the relationships. Everybody trying to build these relationships. So they would bring these artists through, and I said, why don't we ever see them play? You come in here, you take us to dinner, but no one's ever playing. They said, well, you know, they point and they said, well, that guy doesn't have enough material to play for 30 minutes. And I'm like, wait a minute, you signed an artist to a $1 million recording contract and they can't play for 30 minutes? They're like, well, they had this song. So I realized right early on, I didn't finish high school and I could tell the system was broken. You know, just something wasn't right. And I come from the rock world where those bands would just kind of play forever. And they said, well, if no one knows their music, we can't get them paid. I said, what if I could get them paid? They go, what do you mean? I said, just trust me on this. So I called up like 9 radio stations and I said, hey, if I can get us an act at the bottom end of the charts, because this was in California, and it takes a lot of money to get an act from Nashville, California, I said, would you put up $1,500 hotel rooms and dinner? And they're like, absolutely. So I called the record companies. I said, I got the stations. They're like, you got radio to pay? I'm like, yeah. They're like, how did you do it? I said, I went to the sales department. I said, you guys are kissing the butts of the wrong people in the building. It's the sales department. So I created the first ever radio tour that got people paid, got on a lot of labels' radars. They flew me out to Nashville, told me how great the idea was. And then I sat back in California and nobody called. And I'm like, man, I like staying at the Lowe's and the food was good at Roots Chris, but why aren't you giving me any artists? You like this idea? This was like in May. And the answer that I got, you went into the industry for a little while, right? Mm-hmm. You'll understand a lot of what they're saying. They said, well, so record companies have these people called promo people. They're responsible for making relationships with the record radio stations and getting their artists played. Well, during the summer, during the tour, they're the ones running the meet and greets for the bigger artists. So any big act you see on the road in the summer, there's a radio promotion person that's with them handling this. So they said, well, we don't have anyone to take out our baby acts because the radio promotion people are all with the bigger acts. And I'm like, well, that's not fair to the guy that just got signed and had to stop putting out music. So I realized early on that the system wasn't in favor of the brand new artist. So I ended up doing this thing. Scott Borchette at Big Machine Records called, offered me a job to work for Big Machine Records as a promoter. And I said, I'm not qualified. He goes, dude, you are more qualified than you know. He said, you've been helping out our acts, you've been doing all this stuff. And I took that job, and 6 months later, they sent me Taylor and said, teach your radio. What a lot of people don't understand is from 12 years old to 16 years old, all Taylor did was write music. That's all she did. She just wrote music and worked on her craft. She wasn't doing contests. She wasn't trying to do a lot of what you see these kids doing these days. All she did was got the music right. And she had only done a couple of karaoke things and a national anthem, so they said, would you take her out and teach her radio? So her and her mom come out, and part of my story is I went to jail 3.5 years sober because of violating my probation from drinking and driving, and that's a whole longer story. But in there, I met my AA sponsor, and when I got out, he said, hey, you play soccer? I go, yeah. He goes, good. My daughter's team needs a coach. They're called the Miss Americas. They're 12 years old, and that's what they think about themselves, and they've run off 3 coaches, and the dad who's going to finish out the season hurt his back. Would you finish out the season? For my self-esteem, I needed them as much as they needed. But what that led to was me coaching girls high school soccer for 2.5 years. So I speak teenage female. I don't know if it's a blessing or a curse, but that was God preparing me for this teenage female that was going to go on to ultimately change the world. I'm not here to push my religion on anybody else. Just that's just part of my story. So we were together. She wanted to learn. I wanted to teach. Finally, her parents were driving me nuts. I said, you guys got to go find her a manager. You're wearing me out. Dad called one night and he said, I said, how's the hunt coming? He goes, that's why we're calling. He says, Taylor wants you to be her manager. And I said, nope. He's like, not quite how we thought this call was going to go. I said, I'm not qualified. He said something to me that I will never forget. He said, Rick, 1, she believes in you. 2, she trusts you. They never asked me where I went to school. They didn't ask me what my degrees were in. Trust, belief, he said, and you're not afraid to ask for help. He said, a lot of people see not knowing as a weakness. Not knowing and not getting the answer is the weakness, but you don't have a problem asking people for help. Well, I figured I wasted my college years high. I need to go straight to the source. That's why I love everyone talking about mentorship and getting with people to help them out, as I went kind of straight to the source. So I agreed to take on the position, agreed to do it for 2 years. My book's called The $150,000 Music Degree. They offered me a salary, which doesn't happen normally, but they wanted me solely to focus on her. And then in January 2018, I was going to full commission. I was going to be an instant millionaire. And I was gone 187 days, weighed about 300 pounds, was bleeding on the inside, didn't know why. I'm like, all right, God, what's the plan, man? I'll make more money than I've ever seen in my life, but at what expense? Alimony, child support. I know what divorce does because I've experienced it. And I called her up, took her to lunch, gave her a hug, said I'll forever be grateful for the opportunity, but my kids mean everything to me. And I didn't realize the doors that was going to open up, walking away from the money in Nashville. I just didn't know any better. I grew up poor. I never made decisions based on money because I never had it. It was just, it felt like the right thing for me to do at that time. I worked through the Grammys and then moved to Nashville and saw the debacle. Got hired right away at Sony Music. Funny story, they called up Joe Galani, who at that time was the most powerful man in Nashville, And then Scott Borchette at Big Machine were like number one and number two. Totally different personalities. Nobody goes and works for both places. And Joe calls and he said, he was the first person that ever asked me what my goals were. And I said, interesting. I said, well, if somebody saying was showing up in Nashville in sundresses and cowboy boots, thinking that was the magic ticket, and with a blank check for me to make their daughters the next Taylor Swift, and I said, this is kind of nuts. So he said, listen, he said, not to take anything away from Taylor and her family and what Scott and everyone did. He said, but my team saw what you did. They saw the way you trained her and you worked with her. And that's the next lesson, man, is you never know who's watching. You know, we're looking. And he said, I'd love to offer you a job as a consultant for Sony Music. And I excused myself. I ran to the bathroom. I called my wife. I had a BlackBerry. I picked up my BlackBerry. I said, go on Yahoo and type in, what does a consultant do? I said, I'm being offered this job, and I have no idea what it does. So, and my wife's blonde and Polish, so I don't even know if I'm getting the right information coming back to me. She goes, oh, it looks like they advise in areas of expertise and get paid pretty well. So I went to him, and I accepted the job as a consultant, and he offered me $100,000 for 6 months. And I'm like, damn, they do get paid really well. Now, I just left a $150 job, $150,000 a year. Now I'm making $100,000. Another company comes up a few weeks later and says, hey, I understand you're a consultant. I'm like, why, yes, I am. They're like, what's your rate? I said, $100,000 for 6 months. And that's kind of how my journey started. And then I realized that there was no chamber of commerce for the music business, and everybody was getting taken care of, all these families, man. 300,000, 400,000. Here, you can record with this guy. He was on Taylor's record, taking songs to radio that didn't belong, but nobody cared. And somebody, Mike Dungan, who was the head of Universal, he's like, I'm like, man, I wish they would have come to me. I could have protected them. And he said, Rick, there's no chamber of commerce for the music business. And I said, I'm going to become the chamber of commerce for the music business. And I went on YouTube and I said, how to get a record deal, how to get a publishing deal, how to find a manager. And it was all interviews with Clive Davis from like 15 years ago. There was nothing current and nothing. And I thought to myself, I said, I can either do what everybody else in this town's doing, which is crossing their fingers, hoping they land another big fish client that can make them millions of dollars. Red Ocean is music business, Blue Ocean, or I could go find parents that have babies that want to be singers, and I'm the only guy that can say I launched the career of the biggest star in the world at that time, and I can help serve that community. And that's what I chose to do. And I went on Twitter, and I said, hey, I'm going to answer questions about the music business. Anybody got any questions? And I went to GoToWebinar and signed up for their little 30-day trial. I had like 27 people the first week. It's like, oh, this is cool. Then I did it again, and there were like 80 people there, and I'm like, people got questions.
This was for free, or you were charging for this?
I was just free, just answering their questions. It's kind of like market research, you know? Yeah. So then the last one, I had over 200 people sign up, and I only got 200 for free. I would have paid the extra had I known now to get them all on, to get that email list. And then I realized what I had, and a lot of the questions they kept asking was, how do I get signed? You know, why? What's unsolicited material? They were asking all these questions. They were all still thinking industry, industry, industry. And I'm like, you guys don't understand the tools that are available today. You are your industry. So I went to all my buddies that they were asking questions about. And I went to Jim Catino at Sony, head of A&R. And I went to a big time publisher. And I said, I'm going to host this live event. I'll pay you $500 for an hour of your time, but I want to videotape it. And they're like, we'll do it every week, because everybody else just wants to take them and pick their brain. Nobody ever offered to pay them. So I went and I said, hey, I've got all these industry experts coming to this event. If you'd like to buy a ticket, I'm only selling 200 tickets for $97. And I sold out in a second. So I made 20 grand.
Summit.
So then they go and they decide that. So I'm interviewing them. I pay them for that hour. And I offered a product that I haven't even created at that point yet, called the Music Industry Blueprint. It was the four pillars to success in the music business. I had this
framework,
bullshit little thing. Framework. And I sold it for $497. We sold 50% of the room that day, and that's kind of how I got started. And then so you brought up Jeff Walker? Who brought up Jeff Walker? Okay.
What AD did to me.
Yeah. Funny story, and then I'll shut up. So one of my guys at church was teaching Christian managers how to be managers in the Christian music space. And he says, hey, have you ever seen this guy, Jeff Walker? You need to look him up. So I go and I type in Jeff Walker, product launch formula. Now what Jeff teaches is video on one day, video on another day, video on another day, then he's gonna make you an offer. I wasn't aware of that. It's called the product launch formula. And they call it a launch.
So I'm in the hot tub. My only vice is cigars. So I'm sitting in the hot tub. I got the hot tub door flat, my laptop on. I'm having a cigar watching this Jeff Walker video. So at the end of the video, there was no offer. So I go and I get on the email and I was like, hi there, my name's Rick Barker. I'm an online marketing guy. And from one online marketer to the other, I thought you should know that there was no email here for me to be able to purchase your product. And nothing in the video. And they're like, well, thank you, Mr. Barker. Hope you enjoy tomorrow's video. I had my credit card out, man. I was ready to buy. He had the solution to my problem. So the next day, video comes out. I'm watching the video. I'm like, okay, shit, today I can finally get this program that I want. Once again, no email, no buy button. I'm like, fuck you, Jeff Walker. I'm gonna Google search it and I'm gonna find that link online. So I'm Google searching and some guy named Brendan Burchard shows up. So I go and I watch Brendan Burchard's first video. I'm ready to buy. I love what he says. Son of a bitch, I'm in another funnel. No opportunity for me to buy. I'm like, how can I create that kind of anticipation? They were giving their best stuff. And everybody else I saw was like, giving little nuggets. They were giving their best stuff. And I said, that's what I'm gonna do. And that's what I did. And my very first product launch, I did $70,000 in a week, the week of Christmas. And I sucked. They had this copywriter write me all these fancy words that weren't me. And I was using a teleprompter. And that's not me. And I'm sitting there, and you can see, so they got the Taylor Swift plaque because social proof. You can see, if you look real good on those old videos, you can see the teleprompter scrolling down the back of Taylor's hand. And I sat there and I did this thing and I killed it. 70 grand, they said, shut it. So I shut it like they said. I followed instruction. But then I realized, it's my business. We can give you advice and stuff, but it's still your business. You got to test things. Everybody kept emailing me going, I got money for Christmas. Could you open it back up? So now people are begging me to take their money. I'm like, okay. So I opened it up. But what I did was, is I went back in, and even though I had something that was working, it wasn't me. It felt like all these new people were going to find me and see me saying all these fancy lines that weren't me. So I called Jeff and I said, no disrespect. I said, but I got to reshoot the, he goes, dude, you're converting at like 46% right now. He said, don't touch it. I said, it's not me. And now with digital footprints, you put something out in the world, it lives there for a long time. So I went in and I reshot it. And I said, guys, I said, here's the deal. I said, first off, let me apologize. I said, because I'm telling you to be true to who you are. And I wasn't true to who I am. I said, I let a bunch of people try to make me into something that I'm not. I said, you want to laugh your ass off? I said the link down here, go watch that video. I said, bottom line, it's the best course out there because I put everything into it. And I said, if I died today and couldn't talk to another person live, what would I want them to have that could get them going? And shit, I did another 130,000 the week after that, and then I got the book. And then that's when I just went to start finding tools. I said, man, as long as people keep having babies that want to be famous, I got them. But I went and got real good at the social media part and not just posting, but going and getting involved in as many conversations. I'm a member of the Music Entrepreneurs Club because I believe in what they're doing. I pay my $9.99 just like everybody else. And I still go on and teach and talk and do these things, but I drink the Kool-Aid, man. I really do. It's like I want to support this opportunity for us to be able to change lives with music. And on my website, I said, my job is to affect millions of people with songs I never wrote by teaching creatives how to get their music out into the world. That's my small little role in the place. So that's kind of my story, and I'm sticking to it.
I definitely wasn't expecting it to go that way. I was kind of expecting, like, you know, you were going to be in the industry full blown. All of a sudden, you just kind of had this click moment. But it's really like a natural evolution.
It kind of happened the way it was supposed to happen. You know, I got to see behind the curtain. I got to see. It's like, so at Sony, I was the guy on the phones. They wanted me to be outside the system because if you work for a major corporation, you have to play by all the rules in that major corporation. Right. So they wanted me on the outside. So I was the guy on the marketing calls that nobody knew was on the calls. And then I'd create these plans and give them to the label and they would go pitch them to the managers. And then all of a sudden, I knew a lot of these artists because I'd worked on the tours, kind of got them. And I saw none of them were doing anything that I was being paid really good money to create. And finally, I went to the head of marketing and I said, why isn't this happening? I'm just out on the road with Brad Paisley, and I asked Brad, and Brad never saw it. He said the managers didn't understand it because it was all digital stuff. Mm. And these were like old school guys. And I said, then why not just have me come in and explain it?
They said, Rick, here's the problem. They still see you as a manager. I said, if I wanted to stay as a manager, I'd have stayed with the ship that was going like this. I said, so the artist, because here's the thing. All of you who are the artists in this room? Okay, artists, producers, same thing. You get one career. A manager gets like 100 if he wants. So I'm like, so they're jeopardizing this person's one career. And that even kicked me in the ass a little bit more to sit there and say, okay, I need to better educate these artists on the front end so that the record deal is a byproduct of the business that they saw already working, like I did with Florida Georgia Line, which is a whole nother story. I invested in them when every label said no. I signed them to a merch deal. That worked out really well for us at the time too. Yeah, it's like, so I just really, I found my place. I always go in with a servant mentality, man. If I can serve, I just want to serve.
One thing, so from everyone's story, you know, we all come from humble beginnings. One thing that the main question burning in my mind for everyone here is, what were you guys doing to get leads in the beginning? Because I'm sure, you know, you all didn't have money to throw into Facebook ads, Google ads and stuff. What was that creative ways of getting leads in the beginning?
Let me start with me. So I started with giving free beats first.
But how did you even get people to see the free beats?
So I started with the ads, which weren't working.
Right.
And then at some point I did the YouTube stuff, right? And then
I posting tight beats and stuff.
And then I had the link. The first thing in the description box was my link. Kind of didn't work. And then I, at one point, I even like outreached and connected with artists on Instagram. So I was, you know, giving away stuff, and even that didn't work, right? So I had a different approach. So in my journey of realigning myself with my passion, my true passion, which is music production, making music and all that stuff, and trying to, you know, innovate the sales funnels, but on the producer side, I connected with this lady in the ClickFunnels community, and she's like, how about you approach it a different way? And I actually have to come back to that lady and say hi to her and, you know, thank her for the idea that she gave me, actually.
When you're getting your two comma club. Shout her out right? From the stage.
Yeah, exactly. So she said, how about you approaching it in the sense of, if you're a serious artist, then I'm looking to work with you, right? And then I approach it with the survey funnel. So that's why I was doing that. I was doing that before I discovered the group and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So basically you put an opt-in, and then you send them to the step where they fill in a few simple questions about where they're at. You know, if you ever did a music video, if you have made a mixtape, registered with a pro organization kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then they would see the offer page. But my offer page at the time, I was just trying to get them to go to my beat store because I had the Airbit, I had the beat stars. So I got them to go to my beat store to try and for them to buy a beat or something like that. So that didn't work. And stuff
right, right. Lower conversions.
Conversions and stuff like that. So, you know, I had a couple of sales, but it wasn't really working. And I couldn't wrap my head around, how can I create an offer as a producer for artists and stuff like that? And then when I met, you know, gave an idea, it just kind of made sense. I implemented that, and then right away, like within the first week, 1-2 weeks.
When you made that survey funnel, what was the next step? Okay, I click publish on my survey funnel. What was the first thing you did, like, to get people to it kind of thing?
So basically how I structured it is I would tell them, like, when they hit submit, when they enter their answers.
No, I'm talking about how did you get people on the traffic. We're talking about traffic.
Oh, here. Yeah. I was still, like, testing with ads and connected with artists on Instagram and this and that. So that's basically what I've been doing. So I was always complaining about, yeah, I'm on test mode, testing, but really testing doesn't stop. But it's just that, you know, it wasn't working. There was kind of a disconnect there. And then, yeah, that's kind of what I was doing. So at the beginning, the way that I structured it was submit answers and then I'll let you know if you qualify kind of thing. And then I had a button to send them to my beat store.
Okay.
And then, you know, I kind of optimized that until today where it's like completely different. But that's kind of how I was doing it with what I had going on.
Okay. Yeah. What about you, Wishman?
So,
what's those traffic secrets?
So I stepped away from the internet thing for a long time. I'm still in the industry. I still work with artists, but I decided 2 years ago I wanted to come back to doing online stuff because I saw, you know, Superstar O and people like Anno and these guys driving Lamborghinis and stuff.
I'm like, wait, buying houses and yeah, sure.
I'm like, wait a minute, this is something I started. And they took it and ran with it. Not you guys, but I'm saying some of these guys ran with it. And they even, like, I remember Vibe Beats. He hit me. I was like, I know Wish.
Shout out to Vibe.
I was like, damn.
And O too.
And or no, it was either Vibe or Johnny Gulan. One of those guys.
Shout out to Johnny too.
Yeah, shout out to
Johnny too. Yeah.
So I was like, I'm sitting there waiting. And this is the thing about the industry, guys. You get a placement, doesn't mean, first of all, it doesn't mean you're gonna get it. You have to wait. It might be 3 months, and then you're not gonna get paid for 6 months to a year. Guess what? If there's a copyright claim, you're not gonna get paid till that's getting cleared up. It doesn't matter if it's your track or not. So that's when you're talking about chasing it, it's even worse on the back end sometimes. And then, you know, sometimes they're going to ask you for your publishing. And I mean, there's a, I don't even want to talk about it.
It's a whole panel.
A whole panel itself. Yeah. But I decided I could do both. Why not? I want to go back to selling beats online. If I was one of the biggest back then, why can't I be the biggest again? I was wrong. When I first came 2 years ago, I was like, all right, what is type beats? I'm like, wait, so rappers want to buy beats that other rappers use? Back in my day, it was like Timberland type beat or, you know, Neptunes. I'm like, that makes more sense. So I'm like, all right, so I got to make beats in there, and like Lil Wayne to sell the beats? Okay. I'm like, forget it, okay. I was like, I'm just going to go off my name. All right, I'm Wishmaster, Grammy nominated, no one gave a shit. You know, I was like, put it on there, like, oh, that's cool, man.
And that's a testament, because I feel like a lot of guys, when we start with funnels, we think, man, I need those credentials. But you're saying that didn't even make a difference.
It did make a difference. It helped, but you know, with a lot of old school guys, they're like, yeah, I remember Wish back in the day, but they have kids and married. They don't want to buy beats anymore. So they're like, hey, man. You know,
they hung it up.
Yeah. So I was like, all right, I need to do something. So I'm like, all right, everybody's doing ads now. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna do YouTube ads. So I was like, okay, make a little beat video. And I was like, all right, I'm going $2,000 in. I'm gonna do $2,000 for the first month. I was excited. I was like, I ran the ad. I was like, I'm getting all these people coming in. I ain't getting sales. I'm like, what's going on? They're like, oh. And then after the month, I was like, all right, I got like 10 sales off $2,000. Like $25, $50 a pop.
Yeah.
I'm like, this sucks. I cannot do this. And I talked to somebody in marketing. And they're like, well, how did you run your YouTube ads? I said, I just ran it. He's like, oh, you didn't choose the age group or the demographic? I think, no, I just ran it. He's like, dude, you sold ads to every single person in the U.S. or in the world all ages. He's like, just granny's clicking your stuff. He said, especially in China, like, they go crazy on the clicks.
They click on everything.
So I'm sitting there bragging all my, like my friends in the industry, like, dude, I'm going to kill you guys on sale. And I'm like, shit.
Just made you so waste $2,000.
Like, that made me research, and I'm like, all right, I need to figure out what I'm doing here. All right, so I started taking I think it was eSkills. You guys are eSkills.
Oh, yeah.
It's like mm-hmm. Google Ads and stuff like that. So I was like, all right, I'm gonna watch this stuff. I'm like, all right, then I did what everybody probably did here: how to sell beats online, 2019. You know. And I saw some ads, and I'm like, all right, this is cool. It's like kind of like generic. You know what I mean? So I was like, I'm just gonna learn this myself. I'm gonna take some of these Google ad things. And so I started doing Google text ads, and I think that's what really helped and brought in a lot of leads and social media.
Google text ads for beats.
Search ads.
Oh, see, search ads, yeah.
People say, hey, Rappies. And that's one thing, a gem. If you know you guys have done search ads for the free beats, you're not gonna have competition right now. Well, now you are, I guess. But nobody puts free beats in there.
So they just put beats.
They put beats or beats for sale or anything. So if you do it now, you're gonna get like 20 cents per lead. So that's a gem out there. Yeah. But you guys know Google text search ads, so I'm saying?
Like AdWords, right? Yeah, AdWords.
AdWords. That's Google ads. I started doing that, and that's when I started bringing in more income. And then I started with BeatStars. I called Abe, and I reached out to him. I'm like, hey, man, I go by Wishmaster. I don't know if you know you. He's like, dude, I know who you are. Call me. And I'm like, all right, cool. So I called him. He's like, bro, I used to buy beats off you back in the day. And I was like, all right. And he's the CEO of BeatStars. And then he put me onto it, so I jumped on it, and it was cool, but I saw the competition. It was like, everybody has these same pro pages, and I'm like, this is kind of like SoundClick, but with, I guess, your own page, you know what I mean? So I decided to use their platform, but build my own website, because then you start learning about search engine optimization, and having people actually, you get the traffic to your website instead of bringing it somewhere else.
Right.
So that's how I brought, I don't know, I can have one on a rant here, but that's how I brought in my leads, is by doing those type of ads. And social media is huge. You need to reach out to people, give people value. I see Gabe does it all the time. Like, he puts out stuff for artists. So they're like, oh, these are the things you need to prioritize, you know, number one, number two. And I've been doing stuff like that. And sometimes I do fun facts about myself or something, like, did you know I produced I'm on a Boat or something? Or did you know that, you know, I was completely hammered during this session, you know, like that. And then people love that stuff. And when you can be yourself is when I think I got the most leads. When I start talking about the bad things I did, like growing up and just, I'm like, I'm not scared to tell you that, you know what I mean? I'm not scared
telling
to
your tell story.
You I spent $2,000 on YouTube ads and then I was doing, it's just, it's a learning thing. So, I think that's when I started getting more leads, is just being myself and just actually, you know, customer service.
Yeah. Yeah. Me and Wish, we use the bots a lot too on Instagram and Twitter. You know,
oh, yeah, they were good.
It's already followed you.
Oh yeah, those are good.
The DM or whatever, and then I used to do that to get a lot of leads.
That's another lead source, but yeah. Yeah, anymore now.
Recently,
yeah, it's gone.
All that stuff that killed me in the beginning. I was like,
And a lot of times with that stuff is that. I say this respectfully, once the Chinese and those other countries figure this stuff out, it can pollute your list, so your open rates can be lower because they're all from Pakistan or wherever, and that it's just, don't buy anything. Yeah, don't try to impress anybody. It's like, we learned the hard way. I mean, as a joke, you could buy Twitter followers, so I gifted my friends all these fake Twitter followers, so they'd wake up the next day and see they had 10,000 Twitter. It was like, you get like 10,000 fans for $5. It was like 10 years ago, and I was I bought you all these Twitter fans, and it took us forever to flush them out.
Right, now it hurts you.
I bought like 5,000 YouTube subscribers. I'm like, oh, this is going to look great. I'm going to get
sick. Right.
It's like, I spent probably $200, and all of them got taken away from me. I'm like, oh. And then they're like, you can't be monetized for 6 months. I'm like, oh, my God, I just screwed myself.
Be careful.
One thing, you know, you mentioned Google SEO, and I feel like organic search engine SEO is really slept on, like, especially nowadays. Like, just having, like, you have a beat store, whatever, you have a site, you sell whatever, like, having a blog and doing keyword research and, like, you know, you sell beats, right? Like, five things artists need to do to get on Spotify playlists, and, you know, they come on your website and then they get hit with a pop-up that's like, hey, check out, you know, five free beats, you know what I mean, and stuff like that. But I want to talk to you about this, Busy, because you're kind of authority in this, and we were talking earlier. And, you know, your business really started with, you know, just putting out free content, free YouTube content, free tutorial content, really no ad spend. Talk about, you know, the journey to that, and really, you know, the power of free content and YouTube SEO, really, in your case.
Okay, I'll say the abs part first, which is like the motivation to go to the gym, right? We all want abs, so. We officially passed 100 million views on YouTube, which led to a rough estimate of like $250,000 off of YouTube alone, and that's over 800 and something years of influence of watch time, which is like insane. Yeah. So this is like Christ's life.
Yeah. You
know what I mean? Like 2,000 years of influence. I just got to do it four more times. Long story short, the hard work side is, that's how to get the abs. That's the abs, but how to get the abs is, I did 3,000 videos, free everything from like opt-in offers to free advice to countless live streams. So that's where people are like, how do you get as big as you? I'm like, are you really going to sit down and do 10 videos a day for a whole year? Are you really going to do it? Like, I don't see too many people with that competitive gene, whatever it is that kind of motivates
passion,
whatever it is. I think I want to ask you guys before I get into the lead source, which is, what was the moment that put your back against the wall? Because my theory is that we all had to create a decision when our back was against the wall, like burning the books.
I got a $45,000 bill from the IRS, and I didn't realize that having a 1099 meant that you didn't have extra money at the end of the month. No one ever taught me, because I remember I quit high school. I didn't go to college. I didn't know I was supposed to put away money. And that was the first month that I made almost $70,000 in a month, because I had a $45,000 bill, and I thought they were going to Wesley Snipes my ass or something. That was my back against the wall, was getting a bill for money I didn't have because I didn't save.
True. The feeling of seeing the IRS on any mail, but it's like, oh.
I already been to jail. I wanted to avoid prison. You know, I'd been to county jail. I didn't want to go to prison, so that's what got my back against the wall.
Yeah, when you see those IRS letters, it was like, oh, you changed your address. I'm like, why did you guys scare me for 3 weeks? I don't want to open this mail. And they're like, you just changed your address. Put it on record. But yeah, I wanted to ask you guys, like, what was that thing? Because I think that's what separates us from like a lot of folks, is that it was like survival.
Yeah, I would say, I mean, 3 months in, I just was not making anything. I was spending more than I was making, and I was just like, I couldn't get any momentum on YouTube. I was like, this is impossible. It's still tough, but I'm still pushing myself. Running Facebook ads for just selling a beat at a time is horrible.
Yeah.
I tried that, or you just put the little, you know, whatever, Bart Simpson, whatever the hell cartoon is up, and then, you know, and then, oh, this type beat, and it just wasn't working. And I was like, I'm like, I don't need to do this for money, but I'm like, but I want to. I want to succeed at this. Like, I want to grow this, my online business again. And I think it was just, I just pushed through it. And I said, you know what, let me find something. I think it was a little bit after that then I found these guys, and then now I've just been taking it to the next level. So, like that.
That's the soundbite for the commercial.
I was just about to say.
That's the ad. That's the next Facebook.
We're all going to see that on our Instagram feeds.
Yeah, under 2 minutes, put it on Instagram stories.
Why does everyone just say what they think we're amazing?
We made a joke. So at ClickFunnels, Devon, the guy who's announcing it, he's like, and this guy broke the rules. He's selling beats to rappers, and he's talking them all this stuff up, and then out comes this white Jew. You know? Everyone, I said, 90% of everybody thought a black guy was coming out from behind, because they had this big wall, and then it's the smoke comes out, and you don't see it, and all of a sudden, there's this little white dude with the last name Schillinger, you know? It's like...
Yeah, shout out to Gabe though, man. But yeah, man, let's talk a little bit more about really, like, you know, because, you know, a lot of your products are based towards producers. What advice could you give to these guys on different strategies or creative ideas that they can do on YouTube to kind of get that free traffic going and stuff?
Okay, good question. On YouTube, change it from informational to conversational.
Yep.
What's that mean?
Meaning, I used to do a lot of how-to, because I was going after keywords back when YouTube's demand was high for a solution. But now there's solutions answered by me, most likely. So there's no problems left in the market that need that solution of how-to, whatever. So I switched it and said, how can we create a conversation like what you're doing? You've mastered the culture, you've mastered the conversation, like the Tomb interview. It lasted 3 hours. I'm like, the chat was going crazy.
The chat was going crazy.
And you create talking points. I just saw your IGTV channel, and like, you get crazy views on IGTV because you're, that's, okay, so here's the thing. When you're doing tutorial stuff, people hide it. And they're like, I don't want my friends to know how to make the guitar melody. I don't want them to know how to mix their 808s. Cause then
or that I don't know how to do it either. They don't want people to know they didn't know how to do it. They want to feel like they already knew everything.
Right, right, right.
Yeah. That's how social is, yeah.
And they're scared to share it because they feel like giving away something or hiding the fact that they don't know something. So when you start a conversation, it's like TikToks, you want to share it. So you have to do that to go viral. Like our last video did 250,000 in a week, which is rare.
It's like 5 million old school days.
5 million in old school days.
Well, yeah, I mean, because there was only one place to get videos, which is on YouTube. Now everything's a video. So to get 250,000 in a week, that's like getting 5 million back in the day.
Oh yeah, it's like today's money versus 1980. But I think the hidden gem to all this, I'll kind of sum it down because I have a lot of lessons, but I'll cut it short, is that there's two bank accounts. You have your emotional bank account and your financial bank account. And when I went to my girl's play and saw her happy and saw her in her pure joy and I was cheering her on, that led to so much energy in myself that I came home super inspired to make a video. And then I made that guitar video and it did 250,000 in a week. When I came back from this thing called MMI in Atlanta, Millionaire something.
Mind Intensive,
yeah. I came back from that. I was super pumped with energy, the emotional bank account stuff. And then I came back, was inspired to do a video. That same video did create, I think it's at 500,000 or something right now. It went viral. So I think we're missing the energy part. That's why I was asking you about what was the back against the wall thing, because then it forces you to go from negative to positive. Like, for example, you and your girl, okay, when you see your girl, you're super hyped, right, to see her? And it's like...
Shout out to my girl.
Caitlin, right? Am I saying it right? Okay. So... the universe works this way. So females are receptive, guys are forward. I'll keep it like very PG. So imagine the polarity of the universe. I'm not saying you're a negative person, by any means. I just mean you're the negative charge. You're the positive charge. The power of the universe is that when you separate, you create energy in between. So like, for example, if I'm running down the court on a basketball court and I don't crouch down, I can't dunk. But if I run down the court and I crouch a little bit, I build capacity to go from the negative, and then you spring into the positive, into new peaks and new beginnings. So that's the philosophy behind my YouTube approach. Like, we can get into the technical stuff.
Yeah, between these two guys. So
I'm
like,
I was walking, I was getting ready to fail out. Yeah.
So give an example of a conversational... a video that would spark conversation.
What was the name of that guitar, real quick? The guitar video?
It's called like This Guitar Melody Trick Will Blow Your Mind.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Here's my formula. I'll just give this to you because this is the new way of thinking. Go to Reddit, go to every, what do you call them, threads or subreddits?
Yeah.
Type in every keyword you can think of, join every subreddit community, and then sort via hot posts. Anything that's over 100 likes and, you know, has a bunch of comments, you screenshot that. Let's say they're talking about jazz intervals or something like that. Then you go to Men's Health, and they'll you take their headlines. Like, you completely rip their headlines. It'll be like, top 6 ways to get fit abs. And all you do is replace their conversation with their headline. And that's your it's an infinite content machine. You literally don't have to think of anything.
Right, now one down.